pray with him on. Only God, sometimes those sacred texts just startle us and stun us. Sometimes they seem almost too good to be true. And yet how important and critical it is for us to have the ground of hope that comes from the faith that with God all things are possible, whether we can see them or not. So usher us into a new day. Help this time be a time of deeper understanding, growing faith, and an opportunity to become more authentic as we look more closely at your Son, Jesus. It's through Jesus that we pray. Say together, amen. So I've been working on a sermon series. Today we're going to focus on grief, but the series has used a book by the Reverend Peter Wallace. It's called The Passion of Jesus, and there's a picture of Peter. And we've also been using some of the resources from Dr. Marcia McPhee's Worship Design Studio. And I always believe in giving credit where credit is due. So lots of my ideas from the sermon are coming from these two resources, in addition to the texts that were read earlier. So this has all been about emotions and how it is that we name them, claim them, make peace with them, and help us have the passion that Jesus had to be God's presence in the world. So love, and we talked a little bit about anger, fear. This week we're going to talk about grief. And next week we'll wrap up with joy, which knows no generation. Hopefully, so we can be more authentic. So Jesus, fully human and fully divine, and we're in the season of Epiphany. And Epiphany means manifestation. It means, that's what it's about. And we're still unpacking that terrific miracle of Jesus being born, the incarnation, and all that that meant for the people that surrounded him, and what it means for us, and what it's meant for people over the generations. That baby became a man. And that man was a bit of a rabble-rouser. He was a social and religious reformer. He was a healer. He was a prophet. Regardless of who you think or believe Jesus is, he changed the world. We keep our time based on his life. So what we've tried to do with this series is stretch the perception of the meek and mild, tender, soft Jesus who never cried when he was in the crib. I kind of don't really believe that, knowing babies to be human. So it's sort of unpacking maybe some of the lenses that we have been taught through Sunday school or more parochial kinds of teaching about Jesus, so that we can really experience him as a provocateur, as one who was able to be in touch with his emotions so that he could proclaim the good news of God's love for all people, especially those who were pushed to the edges by culture, by politics, or by religion. So let's talk just a little bit about grief. And of course, I make my living with words, and I have to confess almost every Sunday that there are limits to words and language. So it is with grief. We all know it. We all experience it. It's kind of a fact of life. The longer you live, the more you carry it. Can I get a witness on that? So it's a mixture of emotional and physical and spiritual reactions that happen in response to loss. And most commonly, we think about the loss of a loved one. But it also relates to any kind of loss. It could be loss of a job. It could be loss of a sense of identity. It could be a loss of faith. It could be any host of losses can trigger grief. And I, on on the sign outside, it says, grief, the most misunderstood feeling. It's the most misunderstood feeling because it isn't just one feeling. It's actually a cauldron of emotions. So it's complex. And this is, you know, most people, when they think of grief, they envision this. Tears, brokenness, despair. And for those of us who've experienced grief, we know that that's part of it, right? Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, sometimes grief looks like something else. Like, I love Albert Einstein, but have you ever noticed that this picture, he looks totally vacant? Look at his eyes. It's like there's a face, but nobody's home. Sometimes when people are grieving, they laugh. And we might think, oh, they should be crying. Really? Laughter and tears are sort of two sides of the coin. They both can be releases, cathartic. Sometimes there's just the look that looks through you because there's nothing else to do. It's like shock. I'm looking at you, but I'm not really looking at you. And of course, there's my personal favorite when faced with grief, and that's, boy, stay as busy as possible. If I stay busy, I can't process anything, I can keep running away from those feelings, I can just stay busy, just like nothing ever happened. Can I get a witness on that? I'm sure none of you do that, right? I'm the only one that does that. So grief doesn't follow a set formula. I was reminded of my experience as a chaplain at the University of Virginia Hospital right out of seminary. And I remember visiting a family, and this was a family who had a mother who looked very much like this. She had lived a long life, and she had been in the hospital for several weeks, and the nurses and the doctors had done the best they could to take care of her, and her family was gathered. It was a big family, and when she died, they were wailing and crying and carrying on, and the nurses called me on my pager and said, would you get in here and get these people to shut up? And when I talked to the nurse, he said, I just don't get this. I mean, the woman was 95 years old. They knew she was going to die. She lived a good life. And they're still moaning. Yeah, because it's the first time their mother's died. We oftentimes have the expectation that we should get over it sooner rather than later, especially if it's anticipated. No, maybe not. I also, in that hospital chaplaincy, had a rotation in the pediatric ward. And there was a woman and her son who was very disabled. And she stayed with him 3 months in the intensive care unit. And I got a call, because I had been the one who had been with her the longest time, that her son Ryan had died. And I went to that room and I was expecting tears and sadness and remorse. And what I found was a woman relieved, which was the total opposite of what I was expecting. And yet, as I thought about it and processed it with my supervisors, I realized she had been grieving for 3 months. And part of grief is relief. That chapter has come to the close. As his mother, I couldn't do anything to make him feel any better. Now I am released. See how complicated grief can be? Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, in 1969, wrote a book called Death and Dying. I wish she'd reversed the title and called it Dying and Death, because that's actually the way it works. Regardless of that profound study that she did by being with people at the University of Chicago Hospital, and most of us have probably seen this before, but But the first part of grief is denial. You know, this couldn't have happened. Or why did it happen to me? And then it sort of moves into the anger piece of it. Really? Where are you in the middle of this, God? And then it even gets a little deeper. Oh, I should have lived, if I had lived my life differently, how about if I change? Doesn't necessarily bring anybody back. Depression can set in when the reality that you can't bargain your way out of it. And then, acceptance. And here's the thing. This is a cycle. It has stages, but it doesn't follow this nice linear sign. Those of you who study calculus, it doesn't follow that nice line. It usually kind of goes over here, and then back over here, then up here, back over there. Can I get a witness on that? Is that more what it's like than this nice projection? I do want to say, though, that there is an arc to grief. And you'll notice that this arc is just like the story of Holy Week. Because Jesus starts out with this triumphal entrant. Here it is. All of a sudden, anger. He's, let this cup pass from me. Oh my God, why have I been forsaken? It's finished. And you'll notice that this sign, this curve, is lower than this one. So that's the Easter story in a nutshell. Pretty cool, huh? Not bad. Not bad for someone who's almost flunked calculus. So Jesus was human. He knew grief. When he saw Martha and Mary and their brother Lazarus had died, he wept. He cried. And he had compassion for the crowds. There are so many stories about the crowds moving in on Jesus. And the word that gets translated into English most often is compassion. And it's sort of a combination of loving care and maybe pity or just concern and grief. He had compassion because they were wandering around. They had no power and they had no leadership. Jesus commingled grief and anger at the hardness of the religious leaders. That was the healing story today when Jesus laid his hands on the person who had been born blind and deaf. He was just beside himself that none of these religious leaders had reached out to this person and just dismissed that somebody, either he or somebody in their family, had done something wrong and they deserved this. He groaned. And the skies opened. Now some of us might think, okay, but we're not Jesus Christ. We can't do that. But I bet there are more ways that you can provide healing. May not happen miraculously, but they still change lives and bring healing. And there was that last lament over Jerusalem when he was making his way in there, like a hen, a mother hen, gathering her chicks. If only you would have listened. If only you would let love guide you. If only. How many of us have lived with if onlys? So living with grief the JC way is he shared openly and honestly with his friends and with God when he was brokenhearted. He didn't just stuff it. He didn't fake it. He didn't pretend that nothing was wrong. And he didn't let it stop him. He may have paused, kind of like hitting the pause button, right? How many of you felt grief and it's like, pause? I remember when my dad died, I found myself sitting at my desk probably a month or two after he died, and I'm just sitting there staring, and like it's like my brain is not engaged. It's like somebody threw it into neutral. And I remember talking to my senior colleague, and he said, David, it's grief. And I thought, oh yeah, it is. I'm paralyzed. But once that gets named, sometimes you can then hit the play button. Jesus And he responded proactively. And notice that the very first thing Jesus would do is listen. Being present works a lot better when your ears are open and your mouth is shut. Can I get a witness on that? Especially for those of us who like to fix things. Oh, I'm so good at advice. Unfortunately, nobody wants advice unless they ask for it. And most of us don't even want advice. We want a story, right? We want to know, what's it been like for you? Don't tell me what you think I need to do. Tell me how it's been for you. Interesting that there's no place in the gospel where Jesus says, oh, come on, get over it. Now, he might have said that to his disciples upon further reflection. But then again, they'd been with him a lot. He knew grief. So there are ramifications for us. We might ask ourselves, how do we kind of process grief? Do we try to stay with those feelings enough so that they can move us? Because if we don't let them move us somehow, they'll come around here and they'll bite you in the back. They'll bite you someplace else that I can't say in church. All right? And can you leave a crack in your heart for hope? Sometimes the answer is no, I am not ready. Thank you very much. I need to stay where I am. You know what? It's okay. Eventually, to be unstuck, you have to recognize there's probably a broken place in your heart. That's where the light comes in. How might we respond to the grief of others? I will tell you another story about a family at the hospital at UVA. Well-intentioned older church lady who saw somebody crying in the waiting room and found out that this woman's infant child had died, and she said, oh honey, God just needed another angel. She meant well, but if you were that mother, is that what you would want to hear an hour after you'd heard that your child had died? No. The person who said God needs another angel, it probably worked really well for them to deal with that pain, but maybe not so much for the one who's carrying it. So, no platitudes, no, oh, I know how you feel. You know, that kind of patronizing, oh, it'll be okay. We mean well, but we can only deliver hope when there are signs that someone is receptive for it. I don't know. Grief is so sort of universal and ubiquitous. I think I can speak for myself and say I kind of don't want to dwell on it a lot because I know it's going to come my way anyway. But when I was reading Peter's book, I thought, I wonder if you can kind of do like grief exercises or some kind of preparation around it. You'll never get over the shock of something that happens. Can't factor that out. But maybe knowing ways to move through it could help. One of them's talking about it. Finding somebody you can trust. Having a community that can hold you, walk with you, without necessarily knowing what to say or what to do. Can I get a witness on that for those of you who have really been grieving? Yes. Walk. We just need someone to be with us. And can we accept that the whys and the what ifs can destroy the time that we have left if we don't let them go? Some things are just not going to have answers. Or we might not be ready for the answer. And it's better if we don't know it. For somebody who loves to know things, that just drives me crazy sometimes. Can I get a witness on that? I want to know! know more than I do? Oh, yeah, sorry, yes, you do. I'm going to read you an example from the book because it's such a powerful example, and because I bashed nurses earlier, I want to bring some balance to this. This is a pediatric, anybody read Ann Landers? A pediatric nurse once wrote to an advice columnist, Ann Landers, about her experiences offering support to grieving parents. She explained that she wouldn't say, "I know how you feel," because she doesn't, or "you'll get over it," because even though life will go on, it will never be the same. So what do I say? I'll say, "I'm here. I care. Anytime. Anywhere. I'll talk about your loved one. We'll laugh about the good memories. I won't mind how long you grieve. I won't tell you to pull yourself together. No, I don't know how you feel, but with sharing, perhaps I will learn a little of what you're going through. And perhaps you'll feel comfortable with me and find your burden eased." I think that's exactly the attitude Jesus would ask of us toward being with those who are grieving. I can't fix it, but I care. I can't change it, but I'll walk with you. And I just can't resist one of my favorite poems or sayings or whatever. If you can see the text, read it with me. "I would like to beg you, dear sir, as well as I can, to have patience with everything unresolved in your heart, and to try to love the questions themselves as if they were locked rooms or books written in a very foreign language. Don't search for the answers which could not be given to you now, because you would not be able to live with them. The point is to live everything. Live the questions now. Perhaps then, someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing, live your way into the answer." A friend of mine did needlepoint and gave that to me before I went to seminary. And I've never forgotten it. It has spoken to me, especially at those times when I find myself being driven to get the answer. And when I have to surrender and realize I'm beating my head against the wall, and this is really not what God wants for me, and I'm not so effective with the people I love when my head is swollen from hitting it against the wall. Can I get a witness on that? Jesus lived into the question. Some believe he knew exactly what was going to happen during that Passion Week. I happen to believe he was smart enough to know something was going to happen, but he didn't know exactly what was going to happen. But he lived into the questions to give God the opportunity to reveal the power of love. That's the good news, sisters and brothers. May God's love continue to fill you, restore you, lift you up, inspire you, so that you can be a blessing to others and you can claim the goodness in you. The people were heard to say, Amen.